witnesses of the grace of God today. Whether you know him or whether you don't him, you are still a witness of the grace of God. Because you are alive and you are in this room.
Amen.
And we're going to give thanks. Join me to pray. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we just thank you for your grace. We thank you for your loving kindness. We were able to wake up this morning without one piece of us injured or hurt. That is a testimony of your goodness and your grace, Father. Not only us here, but you are keeping our families at peace. Father, we so love you because you first loved us. And you sent your son, Father, to die for every man, woman, and child. And Father, there is no excuse for us not to receive from a good God. Because you love us so much. Father, let not one person in this room escape today without being touched by the presence of the living God. And we thank you for moving by your spirit. We thank you for your anointing on our choir to minister to the hearts of those who are oppressed, depressed. We thank you for saving the lost, for healing the sick, and for setting the captives free. We give you all praise and glory and honor. And let the church say, amen. Glory to God.
Are y'all feeling today?
Blessed! Woo!
It's always so nice to hear that y'all are blessed and to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Today we have a special guest coming to bring us the word today. Very special part of our family, Brother Mills. His message thought today, are you discouraged and need a word of encouraging hope? Are you dealing with a problem that you can't change and need to hold on and an answer that you can believe? Are you facing a mountain you can't seem to climb? Are you walking in darkness of life praying for the day of life? If so, today's message is for you.
Amen.
So that's definitely something I'm sure we all can't wait to hear. Can't wait to feel. If this is your first time to Wings Chapel Gospel Service, would you please stand? Our family grows every week.
Amen.
And that is thanks to you guys that tell everybody about us. So a great big thanks to you. And now we'll take some time to fellowship and welcome our new believers.
All right. Hey.
Thank you.
best friend, my wife, the other day, I said, so I'm preaching here in Spikeman. And they said, oh my Lord, have more people. Take a preacher, had to preach in 6 months and get behind the pulpit. They said, we feel sorry for them. We'll be praying not as much for you, Jeremy, but both of them. She said, don't be like Pharaoh. Don't hold God's people so long. Sweet friends of the Lord that is here, amen. I'm just glad to be saved. I don't know about you. I'm glad that my name is on the roll. And that I make heaven my home. More than anything in this world, that I've got to make heaven my home. I've come to understand how much that I need God. And every single day, and it's usually on the way from the Air Force compound over to the chow hall, I have my little 4 or 5 minute talk with the Lord, and I say, God, I need you more than this next meal I'm fixing. See, God, I need you more than the next drink of water. I say, God, I need you more than the next breath I breathe. For if we have hope, the Bible said, in this life only we live, but of all men, we would be of all men most miserable. I'm glad I have more than hope in this world. This world will pass away someday, but my relationship with Him and His relationship with me, it will continue on throughout, amen, eternity. Man, so glad to be here. Thanks for the chaplain for giving me this opportunity. Amen. To preach. Go ahead and tell you, you know, a locomotive, once it gets going, it's hard to stop.
Amen.
But you don't never see them laying black, you know, they'll never peel rubber out on the railroad tracks. It takes them a while to get going. So it's going to take me a little while to get going, but I promise you, we're going to pull this old wagon down the road. Amen. And I told the choir before service, I said, there's something that I'm used to. Don't make me nervous. I'm used to some CP, what we call it back home. That's some congregation participation. And I also going to go ahead and make the apology that seeing that I am, and I'm relaxed. Is that all right? Can you just keep playing a little bit? Seeing that I am from Kentucky, and all the folks here in my shop know that sometimes they have to take a double take and say, Jeremy, what you say? And I say, party, it's really pretty. When I say far, it's really fire. So if there was something that you didn't get, just see me after service, and I'll interpret what I said. Tell me what you think that I said, and I'll probably catch on. I am going to tell you this morning that I do have a very lengthy reading. Make no apologies for it, but it is a little lengthy reading. And just want to get right into the Word. How about that? If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 2 Kings chapter 4. Amen. 2 Kings chapter 4. Verse 8, and we're going to be skipping through this chapter. Second Kings chapter 4 and verse 8, the Bible says, and it fell on a day that Elisha passed through Shunem, where was a great woman, and she constrained him to eat bread. And it was so that as oft as he passed by, he turned in thither to eat bread. And she said unto her husband, Behold now I perceive that this is a holy man of God, which passeth by us continually. Let us make a little chamber, I pray thee, on the wall, and let us set there him a bed, and a table, and a stool, and a candlestick. And it shall be that when he cometh to us, he shall turn in thither. Verse 13. And he said unto him, Say now unto her, Behold, thou hast been careful for us with all this care. What is to be done for thee? What is thou to be spoken to the king or to that captain of the host? And she answered, I dwell among my own people. And he said, What then is to be done for her? And Gehazi answered, "Verily she hath no child, and her husband is old." And he said, "Call her." And when he had called her, she stood in the door. And he said unto her, "About this season, according to the time of life, thou shalt embrace a son." Now, I don't know about you, but if this is what she's been wanting for a long time, she would be excited about it. But listen to her response. And she said, "Nay, my Lord, thou man of God, do not lie unto thy handmaid." Basically, what she meant was, don't tell me this is going to happen for me to get my hopes up and then for it not to happen and for me to be farther down in misery than what I already am. Basically, that's exactly what was happening here. "Do not lie unto thy handmaid," but the Bible said, "And the woman conceived and bare a son at the season that Elisha said unto her, according to the time of life. And when the child was grown, it fell on a day. It went out to his father to the reapers. He said unto his father, 'My head, my head.' And he said to the lad, 'Carry him to his mother, take him back to mama.' And when he had taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her knee till noon and then died." Everybody say died.
Died.
Died. Verse 22, "And she called unto her husband and said, 'Send me.'" And verse 21, "And she went up and laid him upon the bed of the man of God, shut the door upon him and went out. And she called unto her husband and said, 'I pray thee, one that send me, I pray thee, one of the young men and one of the asses, that I may run to the man of God coming in.'" Verse 32, "And then Elisha was come to the house. Behold, the child was dead. It laid upon his bed. He went in therefore, shut the door upon them twain, and prayed unto the Lord. And he went up and laid upon the child, put his mouth upon his mouth, his eyes upon his eyes, his hands upon his hands. He stretched himself upon the child, and the flesh of the child waxed warm." Verse 35, "Then he returned, walked in the house to and fro, went up, stretched himself upon him, and the child sneezed seven times. And the child opened his eyes." Verse 20 says, "At this baby boy, this blessing, sick, taken him and brought him to his mother, and he sat on her knee till noon, and then that baby boy died." That blessing that she'd been wanting for so long died. But verse 21 says, "And she went up, laid him upon the bed of the man of God." Something happened between verse 20 and verse 21. A decision was made by this mother. And that decision is what I'm going to preach about here today. That mama said this, "I refuse to bury my blessing." Come on now. I'm fixing to.
Come on now.
That's what I'm talking about. Give me some sympathy.
Amen.
This mama said, "I refuse to bury my blessing. It looks hopeless. It's dead. I don't know where to go. I don't know what to do. But I know one thing. I love this blessing too much to bear. I love it too. I've prayed too long. And I've wanted it too bad. It means too much to me. Amen. Just to let it go now when everything looks hopeless. I refuse to bury my blessing." With every eye closed and every head bowed, Savior, we love you again today. We are so very thankful. The mercies of God and the grace of God that have appeared unto all men. Savior, I pray in the name of Jesus, three things would happen here today. Number one, that the ears would hear what thus saith the Lord. God, that number two, that the minds would understand. And number three, that the hearts would receive the engrafted word of God. God, you said in your word that some seed fell upon the good ground, that run for fruit in due season. I pray that the seed of the Word of God find a resting place in our lives and in our hearts and in our soul. And in due season, let the Word of God bring forth. Not return into your void, or accomplish what forth it was sent to do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you. You may be seated with Douglas. Can I grab my water? Hold your church, please. Amen. Thank you very much. There is a natural desire in most women to bear children. Amen. There, it's born into them. It's born into their makeup. It's born into their character. It's born into their nature. That there's something about a woman that wants to bring forth children and give life and have babies. This is a good thing. This is a God-given desire instilled into every woman. And I think if it was up to men, there probably wouldn't be very many people in the world. Amen. Thank God He put it in the loving heart, amen, of a woman. This new beginning. And this desire of this Shunammite woman was no different than anyone else that had this longing inside her to bring forth new life. To bring forth a child. To bring forth a new beginning. To have a fresh start in the world and raising this child and influencing this human being to do great things in the world. And this is put in to everyone. And even so, back in the Bible, you can find out if you are a study of the Scripture, you'll find that in that day, it was a reproach to a woman not to bear children. It was a shame to her that if she did not had a child, that folks looked at her cross-eyed and looked over their eyebrow. What's wrong with her? What's going on with her? Because she had no child. And this Shunammite woman probably no doubt lived every day. Amen. With the cross-eyed looks of people looking over their eyebrow. What's wrong with her? And she lived with this desire of having this new life to be instilled into her. Amen. Just so as that desire is put into every woman, so is that desire installed into the soul, into the makeup, into the character, amen, of every human being. That inside your soul is a longing for God. Amen. There is a hunger that cannot be satisfied. Amen. But without God, there is a thirsting you will never quench without God. There is a void that you will never feel without the presence of the Holy Ghost, amen, in your life. Amen. She had this desire to be born again. Had this desire, amen, to have something installed into her. And so I'm sure every day of her life she dreamed of this faithful. And when she got married and she was a newlywed, I'm sure back in the day she dreamed of the smell of baby powder. That just, man, you smell baby powder and that just smells like a baby. A Johnson & Johnson baby lotion. I mean, it just don't get no more of the smell of the baby, man. Johnson & Johnson baby powder and baby lotion. I'm sure she had a bunch of it because she was, in the very beginning, anticipating having children. I'm sure that she fixed up a room and she put up wallpaper of ABCs of Noah and the Ark and Bob the Builder or something. She fixed up this room because of her anticipation for this new life to be born into her. But now the wallpaper's peeling off the wall because it's been so many years that she's lived without this blessing. She watched other people and they raised their children and send them off to college, and there was always this desire inside her to take this baby and rock it in the rocking chair that her husband made for her. Certainly he must be a craftsman because they built a candlestick and a table and a chair. Maybe he was good at wood and he could just fashion things. And maybe he made her for her first year anniversary. Maybe he made her a rocking chair and she would sit in that rocking chair. And she would memorize, amen, the nursery rhymes, amen, that she was going to sing to that baby because of that desire that was on the inside. No doubt, I'm sure that they picked out girl names and they picked out boy names, and they have fuss and fall over who's going to get it, but somehow somebody won, and it's mostly mama. That's how that baby's going to be named. I'm sure she did. Now she's sitting there in that rocking chair, and she crocheted and sewed onesies and burp bibs. But now those are tattered rags, old dusty rags on an unused changing table. And every time she would probably roll by that room, that longing and that desire for that baby to be born just swelled up on the inside. It never died. The desire for something to be born and something to just to bring forth that life never really went away throughout all the years. And now here comes the man of God. And the man of God began to speak to her. He said, what is your desire? You want me to talk to the captain of the host? Let me talk to the colonel? And he can swing the army by here every now and then and give you some support and make you feel protected. She said, no, I'm fine. I dwell among my own people. Maybe when we talk to the king and put a good word in for you, she said, no, I'm fine. But somehow Gehazi, the servant of the man of God, found out that she wanted a baby. And the servant came back and told Elijah, look here, this woman's wanting a child. This woman's wanting a baby to be born. And the Bible said that he called her and she came and she stood at the door. And he looked at her and said, according to the time of life, thou shalt embrace a son. Nay, my Lord, thou man of God, do not lie in thy handmaid. Don't let me get my hopes up that something great's fixing to happen. Just for it not to happen and for it to come crashing down in disappointment. Isn't it hard and isn't it rough sometimes when we are promised something? Someone calls you, I'm sending a care package of dark chocolate and raspberries. Amen. Your favorite thing, that favorite whatever it is, and you sit and you go to that mailbox every single day. Why is it that because of the anticipation of what was promised to you? And you know what? And more times than not, since I've been here, it hadn't shown up yet. And I keep lying to myself that they really didn't forgive me. It's lost in the mail, praise God. You know what? That's my way of dealing with the disappointment. I really wanted that dark chocolate. She said, look here, don't tell me it's going to happen if it's not going to happen. But I'm telling you, when God says something's going to happen, it's going to happen. Come hell or high water, if God says it's going to happen, I don't care how impossible it looks. I don't care how difficult it looks. I don't care how outrageous, outlandish. Amen. You say he would take a miracle. Well, the God that I serve is great in miracles. Because y'all remember how back in the first, second, third elementary school, they'd have the answers in the back of the book every now and then. Especially the multiplication table. Man, that saved me a many a day. And sometimes it didn't give you the right answer, but it gave you another answer. You figured out how they got it, and so it helps you get it right. So in essence, you found the answer in the back of the book, right? Well, I'm cheating life. You know what? Amen. I just read the back of the book, and the back of the book says, we win.
Servants to work in the field.
Well,
You know how I know that was, he was poor? Because Daddy was so rich, he could build a room in his house for just somebody that walked by. I'm telling you, the mortgage was going to pay it off. And they wouldn't know no on the escalator. He wrote checks for the cruise to the Bahamas. The Bible said, he found that the baby was born. I'm telling you, man, when that woman got pregnant, she put another pastel color on that baby room. She went down to Home Depot and she bought more wallpaper. She went to Walmart and bought all that stuff. Hallelujah. Y'all hear what I'm talking about? I'm talking about one spoiled little boy. I'm telling you, it wore shoes, nice shoes. Hallelujah. It had all the good and the finest things of life. But the Bible says, amen, that blessing came. One day of great rejoicing and one evening of painful years. As she looked into the deep eyes of that child, all of the years of suffering vanished away. All the years of praying and hoping and wishing and discouragement was gone away. As she just wiped that snotty nose. You get what I'm talking about? Amen. Every time she didn't mind to change them dirty diapers. She didn't mind and grub and grime. Amen. And cry and complain when she had to get up in the middle of the night to change it and defeat it, because she knew that it was a fulfillment of the long-awaited blessing in her life. But the Bible says, and there came a day. I don't know about you, but I've had many of those, and there came a day. Actually, I've had about four or five too many of those, and there came a day. The Bible says that there came the day that that blessing, that child, amen, said unto his father, my head, and that child was carried to mama, taking back to mama. There's something about a mother's love that us men will never understand. There is something about a woman that holds that child. Amen. I'm going to tell you how in the world that can a little small peck of the wet lips on a scraped knee heel. Amen. I'll never know, but somehow it does. You know what I'm talking about? Mama. Mama's voice on the phone chases all the fear away. Amen. Mama's touch on the hand just makes all the world worthwhile. Something about mama. The Bible said he took him back to mama. He laid on mama's knee as she stroked her his hair, and she caressed his face and massaged his legs. And the Bible said that that child, in spite of all of her love, in spite of all of her tears, in spite of all of her pain and all the things that came out of her heart towards that child, that day the Bible said that baby died. But I'm here to tell you, that baby wasn't dead in mama's heart. The Bible says that mama took that lifeless baby. Mama took that blessing that seemingly to be dead. When everybody else would say, call the funeral home. When the critics say, call in the mourners and let's come mourn. Anybody got critics? I got critics. I got them out the ears that tell me that I can't make it and that I can't. And put a wreath on the door. Put black on. Amen. Because today is a day of sorrow. Oh, you know what mama said? Amen. Mama said, I waited too long for this blessing. I lived too many years without this blessing for me just to throw in the towel and the quit and the walk away when things don't look easy and everything ain't going my way. I refuse to bury my blessing.
Come on, give me some victory,
small steps they may be, their progress
singing. Keep singing all the night long. When I'm broke, hungry, sick, and barely able to survive, even I just keep breathing. Keep breathing. Thank God I'm still alive. That's how I feel about it. I'm going to be saved. Come hell or come high water, come the devil, come situation, I refuse to bury. Amen. My blessing. Amen. Can I preach to you now for a little while? Amen. Amen. We're fixing to pull the locomotive's picking up steam. Hallelujah. We put in the clutch and grab another gear. Hallelujah. Amen. There came a time in my life, and there came a time in your life, when we was long awaited something to be born into us. Amen. There came a time that sin just got old. And there came a time when the world just wasn't fun. And there came a time, amen, that the end result of sin, which is death, come crashing down on our world. And then we walked in that church, and we felt the presence of the Lord. And we felt the mercy of God. And you know what God did? He saved us. We was born. Great, awesome, wonderful relationship with God in our arms. And when we stumbled and we fell, but we kept on living for God. We kept on trying to make hungry. Amen. Our hunger for truth. We became thirsty for God, and then it came. That great experience. That Holy Ghost experience. Amen. That great, awesome, life-changing touch of the Lord. But all of a sudden, we're living life, we're living large, we're living God, everything is going great, everything's going well. And then there came a day. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm talking about. When something seems to take away the joy, and something seems to take away the excitement about living for God, it's just a mountain too high to climb. It's just a valley too long to cross. It's just hurt beyond imagination. It's pain beyond reasoning. And it seemingly has been that our blessing, the thing that we long for and desired so much for, is now lying lifeless. And we find it hard to get excited about living for God. We find it hard to get up and pray. We find it hard to read a Bible and be faithful to church, because this death that has come into our lives has stolen away the joy of living for God. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
You know what the sound that some people hate and dread the most? Not because they're lazy, not because they're worthless, but it's the sound of an alarm clock. It's not because they don't want to get up and do what they have to do. It's because the sounding of an alarm clock is nothing more than the sounding of another day of hurt.
That's right.
And another day of pain. And another day of sorrow. And they wish they could just sleep their life away, because they know they have to get up and face awake another day. Amen. But the blood trail of their bleeding heart. Amen. Leaving a blood trail everywhere they go. You know, I'm not a prophet. I'm not a son of a prophet, Colonel Thompson, but I've lived for God enough to know, amen, that in this room here today, that if we could see in the Spirit, amen, Chaplain, that there are people with bleeding hearts. Amen. You woke up this morning, got dressed, came to church. Amen. No one knows, no one sees, no one understands exactly where you are. Amen. You hid it from your co-workers. You hid it from your friends and your family. Amen. But if I could see the blood trail from that door down the aisle, down the pew, even right underneath your trail, underneath your chair, you're sitting here with a bleeding heart, even saying, what in the world am I going to do? I don't just feel like throwing the towel. I feel like quitting, but I've come to tell you, amen, that the greatest thing you can do is just put another notch in the rope and hang on. Listen to God. I know a God that's a I know a God that sees, that cares, and that understands the way that I take. There's nothing hid from Him. He knows and He sees. But we have an adversary.
Yes.
They would love nothing more than for you to just go out there in the backyard of your life and dig a hole and bury this blessing. And just say, I give up and I quit on living for God. I'm just going to just throw you in the towel and I'm going to walk away. But I've come to tell you, there are just some things I refuse to bury. There's just some things I refuse to give up on. There are some things that have held me through thick and through thin. Amen. There are some things, amen, that the devil didn't give and that the devil can't take away.
Amen.
There are some things that the world didn't give me and the world can't take them away. Amen. The things that have been given to me came from heaven. Hallelujah. And I refuse to throw it away. I refuse to waste it away. Amen. With the things of this world and full of discouragement and being weary, I refuse to give up. I refuse to bury the blessings of God in my life.
Yes.
What are those things, Brother Mills? Amen. You know what? Amen. Repentance has just done me a whole lot of good in my life. And I refuse to give it up. Amen. I'm going to hang on. I'm going to snot and cry. Boo-hoo. Hallelujah. And be tearful. Amen. Because finding a place of repentance, amen, has drawn me closer to God. Romans 2 and 4 says, the best after church. Just hang on. 2 Timothy 2:25, and meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, for if God prevents, would give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. Acts 2:38, and Peter said unto them, repent. Acts 3:9, repent thee therefore.
Yeah.
And be converted. I like this verse. That your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Acts 17, 30, in the times of this ignorance, God waiteth, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. 2 Timothy 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning His promises, as being countless, but His long-suffering towards us, Lord, willing that not any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Revelations 3:19, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten, be zealous therefore and repent. I refuse to bury that principle in my life. Amen. The enemy might want to say, just throw it in the town and quit. Amen. Baptism, Acts 2 and 38. And Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. Luke 24:47. And that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in His name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Acts 2:41, and they gladly received His word and were baptized. Acts 8:16, as for He had fallen upon them. And only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Acts 10:47, can any man forbid water that they should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? Romans 6:3, know ye not that so many were baptized unto Jesus Christ, were baptized unto His death. Amen. I need that remission. That washing away. Even a touch of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Acts 2:38, and Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Acts 8:1, or Mark 1:8, and I indeed baptize you with the Holy with water, but he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. Acts 1:5, for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Verse 8, but ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Acts 2 and 4. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues, and the Spirit gave them utterance. Acts 2 and 33, therefore, being on the right hand of God, exalted all, having received with the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, He had shed forth what you now see in Him. Amen. The touch of the Holy Ghost, the touch of God in our lives. And there are just some things I refuse to give up. There's some things I refuse to lay down, some things I refuse to hold on to. You know what? We have many gods in this world, many gods who pull us, many things that try to exalt themselves and rule our lives. Amen. But we must understand that there is just one God. There is just but only one God. Amen. Deuteronomy 6:4, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God. Amen. He is one Lord. Isaiah 45:18, I am the Lord and there is none else. Isaiah 44:8, is there a God beside me? Yea, there is no God. I know not any. Micah 2:10, have we not of our Father, hath but one God created us. James 2:19, thou believest there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. Romans 1:20, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things which are made, even his eternal Godhead, so that they are without excuse. The list goes on and on and on. Amen. Amen. I refuse to bury those things that held me true and faithful to God. I refuse to bury even my blessing. You know, the Bible says, be not deceived of the devil's devices. When I think of a device, I think of something that you hold. Think of a tool, a device. A device does something. It has a purpose. It's not a knick-knack. It's not a pretty. It's not something you look at. It's not a picture. It's something that you hold. The Bible says, be not deceived of the devil's devices. Well, I tell you what I've done. I went to the devil's tool shed. And I got some of the devil's stuff. Colonel Thompson, I'm just going to reveal the devil's stuff. Is that all right? I just snuck in his tool shed this morning. Brother Stamps, if you could help me out here. And I just stole something from the devil. Hallelujah. Here we go. Hallelujah. The Bible says, be not deceived of the devil's devices. You know what this is? It's a device. And you know what it does? It digs. You know what it digs? It digs a hole. And you know what the Bible says? That we ought not to be ignorant of what the enemy is trying to do. I've come to just expose him for all that he's worth. And let you know that what the enemy is trying to do in the middle of your discouragement, in the middle of your trial, in the middle of your tribulation, in the middle of your trouble, amen, unbeknownst to you, just slip a little device in your hand that will help you and that will aid, amen, in you digging a hole and burying the things that God, amen, has blessed in your life. You hear what I'm talking about? Amen. I've come to tell you, I refuse to have this device in my hand. I refuse to have the things that the enemy like to slip in my hand and just make me bury the things that God, amen, has done in my life. You know what he like to do? He like to slip discouragement. Come on. He like to slip discouragement in your hand. You get so discouraged about living for God that you just don't go on anymore because you're just full of discouragement. You know what? I've come to tell the devil he can go back where he came from. Amen. I refuse to be discouraged. Amen. I refuse to be discouraged. You know what else? Have you been discouraged? Yes, for a little while. It's long enough it takes me to go to church and find a prayer closet somewhere and pray through the Holy Ghost. And I'm all right and I'm okay because I refuse to marry my blessing and I refuse to be discouraged.
I'm not really a poet, but I've wrote a couple of poems in my lifetime. And I tell you how I feel about discouragement. You all right? I tell you how I feel about it. This is my attitude about going on living for God. Amen. It says this. It's called the conclusion of the battle. How fitting. Amen. This is the conclusion of the battle that I'm in. I will not succumb to my body and I will not surrender to sin. For every day when the sun would rise, I'll clench my fist and I'll narrow my eyes. And determined, I will not die in this battlefield of life to sustain the strife. I have more determination and withstanding desire when life throws a curve and hell turns up the fire. For you see, there is a standard that I'm trying to defend for its righteousness, peace, and hope among men. And if for it's what I'm trying to protect, the reason why the enemy is so hostile. For you see, I've been commissioned in this battle to carry the gospel. And again, I say this is the conclusion of the battle I'm in. I will not quit. I will not stop until I die and end the battle's in. Beautiful girls, and when I say they are beautiful, I mean they are knocked down gorgeous. But God means more to me, amen, than them. You know what? I've got the foxiest wife in the entire world. I'm telling you, woo! Hallelujah! Amen. I ain't lying to you. I got the pictures to prove it. You know what? God means more to me than her. Hallelujah. You know why? Because hell is hot and eternity is long. And I've got to make heaven my home all by myself. And I refuse to be discouraged. Amen. I just got to keep on pressing on. I got to keep on making heaven my home. But whatever comes my way, I got to keep on trying.
Yeah.
You'll put it in your hand and get you discouraged. Amen. Weariness. You're trying to put weariness in your hand. Just get you just so tired. Just beat on you day in, day out, until you just become weary, until you just become just flat out tired. Amen. I'm not a poet. I don't read you that. I'm just, you know. I'm preaching. I can do that. Hallelujah. Just get you weary. Get you tired. Listen to what this one says. It's, how is it that on this road of life, there's somebody that's going to be able to relate with what I'm saying here. How is it that on this road of life that some are giving nothing but hurt and pain, and yet you see them continuing on without slowing stride, and with faithfulness they remain? How can weariness be discarded and discouragement so violently cast aside? Where is this fortitude found? Where in the caverns of their character does it abide? The answer is hidden in the bottom of their heart, tucked away in the recesses of their soul. It's the place where the fire burns and the eternal embers glow. Give us a name for this motivation. What if the fervent fuel for this fire is nothing less than the will to live? It's truly an undying desire.
Amen.
I refuse to be weary. I refuse to give up. Even, you know what he'd like to do? He'd like to put carnality and worldliness even in our hands. Amen. You know what? We're not of the world.
Amen.
We don't act like the world. We don't talk like the world. We don't live like the world. We don't think like the world. Amen. Because we're not of this world. Amen. We're of the things of God. You know what he'd love to do? Just slip this carnality and worldliness even in your hand. Better compromise. Compromise your convictions. And compromise those things that you've held so true and unbeknownst to you. Amen. He just slip that this old shovel of carnality and compromise even in your life. And before you know it, someday you're out there in the backyard of your life digging yourself a hole and burying the things of God. Even, I don't know about you, I refuse to bury it. I refuse to bury it. Can I get some music in closing? I won't hold you long. I refuse to bury, amen, my blessing. You said, well, Brother Mills, you know, there's different groups of people that are here. There are those who have never had the blessing. Those of you that have never been partakers of the powers of the world to come and tasted of the heavenly gift. There are those that are here. Kind of hard to hear something you've never had. Isn't that right, sir? Good shape. It comes to that. Then there are those of us who, man, we're just, man, we're blazing.
holding up the bloodstain, holding up the torch, we build the kingdom. God bless you. God bless you. But there's that one group that used to be. That one that's just struggling, that's just having a hard time living for God. Having a hard time because of life, because of somebody else has hurt you so bad. And it's burned the vision of the kingdom. Situations has gone so wrong that it just drains you of all of your emotions and all of your thoughts and all of your heart. And you just survive. You're just existing from one day to the next. You just kind of got into the rut of coming and going, coming and going. Sleep, eat, work. Because that hurt and that pain.
You say, well, Brother Mills, I've sat here in this whole sermon with a
lump in my throat and a knot in my stomach and choking the tears back. Because I know that in my heart, I'm coming from the backyard. I done buried it. I want to tell you how great of a God that I serve. I want to tell you how great of a God that I serve. I serve a God that is so great that in this service has went to the backyard of your life and He's dug it out. He's reached down there and He's taken that very stitch or something that you had with Him. And He's polished it. He's cleaned it. He's made it just like it used to be. And all you've got to do is say, God, I want it back. God, I'm sorry for burying it. I'll never do it again. God, here I am. For me, that's easier said than done. You know what? I know. We all know. That's easier said than done. But the Spirit of the Lord is in this house. The presence of God is here. What is that something that I feel? That's the mercy of the Lord is blowing in this house. The mercies of God. Drawing us to repentance. Drawing us to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Drawing us to find Him. Could we close our eyes and bow our heads? I refuse to bury my blessing. I refuse to bury the principles of doctrine of truth that has held me for so long. Repentance and baptism in Jesus' name. The infilling of the Holy Ghost and holiness and the walk with God. These things have held me secure in my life. I refuse to bury. And I refuse to allow things to be put into my hands. Weariness, discouragement, carnality, compromise, and rebellion. The mercy of the Lord. I'm not one of those preachers that will try to scare you to live for God, but the Bible does say that my mercy when I've always strived with man. When I promise tomorrow, there has never been a day called tomorrow is always today. There's no such a thing as tomorrow. It's the lumen of your imagination. It doesn't exist. There will never be a tomorrow. It will always be today. The Bible says that today is the day of salvation. Amen. The Lord calls today. God, we love you. Savior, we're so very thankful for your mercy and grace. God, we need you today. More than ever before, more than anything in our lives, God, we need you. God, we need you. I pray today for that certain somebody that's hurting, struggling. And no one sees and no one knows but only you and God. Pray the Spirit of the Lord and touch of God. What a merciful God, what a wonderful Savior that we serve. God is here to renew, to refill, to strengthen, to encourage, to uplift, to reunite with Him and you. What you feel is the mercy of God, the grace of God that hath appeared unto all men, that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, that we might live righteously and soberly in this present world. I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to do a little bit something different. If we could stand here. You know, so many times we get put on the spot. Sometimes. To come up front. You know, I'm going to make it easy for some of us. If you'd like. No pressure, but if you'd like. See, there's some folks that say, you know, I'd like to go up there and pray and talk to the Lord. You know, if I did that, folks would know something wrong. Man, if everybody would just go, then no one would really know who is and who ain't and who needs and who doesn't and who's good and who's struggling. You understand? So I tell you what, I know it's a little bit different than what we usually do it here, those who are the regulars understand, but I tell you what I'd like for us to do. If I could get someone to sing a song, could someone get ready to get up at it, something slow. And choir, we could do that right off the cuff, man. We didn't know time. Against the unseason and out of season. It's a slow song, if we could sing it. I tell you what I want us to do. I appreciate that. You know, just for a moment. Maybe we all can just kind of gather around the front. If you're comfortable too. See, no one knows who is and who ain't. But only God. Got a wonderful thing about it. I tell you what, can we just... I know we just... God sees. Maybe you're sitting next to your buddy or your friend or someone you know or someone you don't know. If it'd be appropriate, maybe just take their hand or put your hand on their shoulder. I tell you what, we're going to ask God just to restore some things in our lives. Don't be afraid to let your hands raise and those tears fall. We're all dealing with things back home that we can't change. We can't deal with it. And the devil will try to tell you just to quit. It's no use and it doesn't matter, but it does matter. And the mercy of God, the grace of God is here today. And God's here to minister to your lives and minister to your heart. I tell you what, can we just talk to the Lord right now? God, we love you. Savior, I need you more than anything in my life. Just for this moment. God, I'm away from the war. I'm away from doing convoys and flying missions and fixing automobiles and helicopters. But God, I'm in church right now and I'm hurting. I'm in church and I need you, God. I'm in church and my heart is heavy and I'm just worried. There's things back home that I can't change and I can't deal with. I just need you to lift the load. Need you, God, just to take it all away for a little while. God, I love you. God, I love you, Jesus.
That's it. God hears that prayer. That's it. Just for a few more moments. God sees them tears. Just go ahead. That's it. God, I love you. God, I need you. I refuse to bear. God, I'm weary. God, I'm tired. God, I'm discouraged. And I refuse to give it up. I'm hanging on, God, the best that I can. But if you would help me, something's going to happen. God, if you don't help me in my time, God, I can't make it alone. I can't make it without you. Sweet Holy Ghost. Sweet Holy Spirit. Sweet Heavenly God. In the name of Jesus, the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost. God, touch my family. Touch my family. Be a father to my children. Be a mother to my children. Be a companion to my spouse. Be a child to my parents. For he careth for you. Casting all of our care in the name of Jesus. God, I refuse to give up. God, I refuse to give up. Hallelujah to God. Just a few more minutes, good Lord. Inside these walls, we can really cry out to God. Hallelujah. We can really make our petitions known before Him. Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah to God. Hallelujah to God. Hallelujah. One more time. If we lift up our voice and talk to the Lord, I'll be ready today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your spirit. Thank you for the mercies of God. God, I pray for every soldier and every airman that is here today. And they will go back to their rooms, back to their jobs, to whatever it is. And let the remainder of this day be full of the Holy Ghost. Let them take with them the Spirit of God that we feel right now. Back to the room and let the peace of God, peace I've given to you, Jesus, and peace I leave unto you, not as the world gives, give out unto you. I speak peace in the name of Jesus on every soldier, every airman here today. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah to God.
Person hit by the power of God. You need to get more involved and hang.
hang around, it involves the deep things. And you need to ask God to let you experience getting involved in stuff like that. I tell you, because I've seen people hit by the power of God and change. I mean, change. No more prostitution, no more drugs. That's what you call a real move of God. And we really appreciate you coming out and sharing with us. You know, it's all about different people have different anointings, and everybody don't preach the same, everybody don't teach the same. Just allow God to use you just as you are.
That's it.
And so we really appreciate that. Those of you that have accepted the Lord, if there was a accept the Lord in your heart, we have some powerful people that are around. We're talking to the chaplain right here after service, Chaplain Santiago, Minister Beholder, myself, for sisters, our guest right here, Sergeant Hustler. And I'm Sergeant Hustler. That's good. I'll tell you about, this is a powerful lady. You gotta watch out for his quiet ones. She's a powerful lady in the Lord that I've met over there in Cash. She works over in Cash. She helps coordinate for our medical training for our clip team. But a powerful lady in the Lord, some of you ladies that accept the Lord, go talk to her. You know, we got Sister Rouse and Captain Chief. We got all kinds of people that are on fire for the Lord, that you have no excuse that you can hook up with somebody and be encouraged. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Captain Rouse, come on up with the announcements.